the museum's job, it's scientists of the museum, it's our job to try and understand Australia's biodiversity in Australia and how it relates to the wider Indo-Pacific region. So I'm going to tell you about a very different sort of sampling expedition that I was involved with, very lucky to be involved with, just to give you a perspective that we don't only do shallow water environments where we can scuba dive, we also, when we get the opportunity, work in the deep sea. Thanks, Mika. So I was very lucky to be involved in a joint expedition with CSIRO and a number of other universities and museums in the Great Australian Bight a couple of years ago, and we were trying to understand geological and biological processes in 3,000 metres of water in the Great Australian Bight. So we used a ship called the Remotive, which is not usually a research ship, it's a ship of the oil and gas industry. But the reason that we're using this vessel is that it has had remote operating vehicles, which the usual research vessels that we have access to don't have ROVs or remote operating vehicles. And the sort of sampling we were doing required them, so we were on this ship for about a month in the Great Australian Bight. So this is an ROV being launched. The vessel had one of these on each side, a port and starboard ROV, being launched over the side of the ship. These things can be used up to reasonably rough conditions, but obviously there's times when we couldn't use them. On the previous picture of the ship, you saw that big helideck over the top of the ship, and they measured what they call the heave, which is the vertical movement of the helideck. And at one stage when on this voyage in the Southern Ocean, the heave on the helideck was 14 metres. And obviously in those conditions, we couldn't really work. So there are limits to being able to use this gear. But we managed to do most of the things we set out to do. So launching the ROV off the side of the ship has very fancy equipment that allows it to stabilise within about a metre of its position on the surface. And this is how it works. This is lowered down. This stays below the ship, and then the ROV with this secondary umbilical cord trundles along the bottom. So this ship's stationary. This is stationary, and then this cord. So there's one of these on each side of the ship, and it's very complicated to make sure they don't tangle and get tangled up with each other. And they have very skilled pilots on the ship who are able to run the ROV. Obviously, we weren't involved in that side of things. So all of our sampling was done with this big claw. We had a number of devices that it could pick up. We had a cassette of different sorts of equipment lined up here, and the claw would grab, and there were things like we had a fish and chip bucket, literally a fish and chip strainer bucket thing. We had little scoops. The gear that this claw was picking up was very simple equipment, and we would direct the pilots of the ROV as to which bit of gear to pick up to sample the particular animals that we wanted them to sample. So we had, after the ROV had taken the sample, we had this setup of, we call these quivers. These were cores that were pushed into the sediment by the ROV. And then these were little pockets where, and each of these was numbered, and they were numbered so that when the ROV came up, we knew exactly which pocket of in that quiver, that where exactly where the sample had come from. So that was our setup. This is the ops room where the biologists worked. There was an ops room for the pilots, but this was our ops room, where we could look at, we could see real-time camera images of the ROV. We could see where it's going. And the pink thing above, which I'll show you another picture of that, shows us what mapping had been done by the ROV. So we were the biologists and geologists. We were running 24-hour shifts, sitting in this room, talking to the pilots in the next room, as to what we wanted them to sample and how we wanted them to do it. So this is how we kept track of the ROV. The pink lines is where the ROV's been. So this is the ship, and there's an ROV on each side, and as it trundles up and down, the pink line shows us where it's been and where it's up to. We were sampling 400 metres by 400 metre sampling sites on each side of the ship. So the ROV was trundling up and down, 400 metres, up and down, up and down, up and down. And all of these are samples that we wanted to take. So we'd sit there and say, we'd mark off everything that we wanted. And then at the end of the sampling, we'd direct the ROV back to the particular samples that we wanted. And in the deep sea, there's a lot of things that are look just like we see in shallow waters. This is 2,000, you can see up the top there, it says 2,142 metres. So a lot of the animals that we see look just like shallow water animals, but equally there are all sorts of weird and wonderful things in the deep sea that we never see in shallow water. This is on a drop-off, so you get features on the bottom of the deep sea in the same way as you do in shallow waters. This is a big bird. And one of the things that geologists were trying to understand is how this, was this a recent slump or was this a very old feature, geological feature? So here we are, the ROVs come back on deck, so everyone's busily emptying the quivers, getting the gear, getting everything down onto the main working deck so that we can start working on the samples. Similar to us after, and then we had to clean it all. So on the back deck of the ship, similar to what we set up in the garage here in Tathra, we had these big containers, chemical and geological labs, and we set up a working bench on the back deck, and that's where we processed all our samples. So a lot of the animals are, as I said, they look similar to things we see on land. Often the crustaceans are really bright red in the deep sea, just to show you some examples of the sorts of things we were finding. Squat lobsters are very common. These are very common in the deep sea. You get large numbers of these guys in the deep sea. And then some things are very familiar. Brittle stars, which you find here in Tathra underneath rocks, we're finding them on the wharf. In the deep sea, they can be huge, absolutely huge numbers. You can bring up a trawl that's just crawling, the deck gets covered in brittle stars. So they can be very abundant in the deep sea. And sponges, you get a particular sponge in the deep sea which has glass spicules. Sponges in the shallow water don't tend to have these. So this is a particular, this sponge is particular to the deep sea. And some weird and wonderful fishes in the deep sea. So that just gives you a view of another sort of thing that the museum does, just to show you that we don't just work in shallow water and that we collaborate with CSIRO and other universities and museums to do major collaborative projects.